For some unknown reason, you can't complete something at a given time, then of course we will try to agree with you that you can release the single feedback, but it still requires your permission to release that. Students really struggle with it if you present from different voices. So we don't want to create that confusion. Of course, if you get into a higher level, if you finish your proposal and you're presenting your work later, it is definitely to the benefit of doctoral students specifically to hear from a multitude of voices, because it's very difficult then for them to understand that one of the key characteristics that binds any university staff, academic staff, is a lack of parking and disagreement. I mean, that's the one thing that you absolutely guarantee to have. We train to disagree, although we do it very formally through writing papers and all of those reviews, but we train to disagree and we never find parking. So that's consistent. So these timelines are really tight. So the purpose of this, as I said, it has a number of smaller purposes and bigger areas. The main purpose is about support to the proposal development process. So this support is given predominantly to the students, but we're also providing some support to the supervisors, and most of that would be around rubrics and formats to evaluate that maps against the final requirements of a thesis or a dissertation. So some of that is given through. If there's anybody that needs anything else or need to discuss or disagree fundamentally with something, they are free to come and have that discussion. It's not that this is absolutely cast in stone. We're following the process. If you are following a research method or you feel more comfortable about doing something differently, let's talk about it. So it's not this is the way to do it and it's the end of it. We also mostly want time as development of proposals. One of the biggest things that holds a student back is when their proposal is not on time. A thoroughly developed proposal, and you can start nearly painting by numbers or carrying on and doing the little bits and complete it. But if you don't have a thorough proposal, then everything else gets delayed. So we get people either developing a very short, quick proposal that has to then be redone over and over again, or we sit with people that don't do their proposal in time and then gets longer. A master's degree is supposed to be done in how many years?
Two.
Maximum. That's expected. Two. Doctoral?
Three.
Okay. How long does it take people on average to do it?
Four.
Lots longer. I mean, I can't say that I've done mine much quicker, but it's not a fast process. Now the luxury, the typical way that one does it is by having a discourse. You have a supervisor, you have access to the supervisor, and over a time you have the opportunity to talk to the various students and have different opinion, and you slowly form. If you're fortunate and you get assigned a supervisor quite early in the process that's interested in what you do, okay, which is quite fascinating sometimes, and really knows how to guide your thoughts and that you feel affinity to. Because remember, people think differently. And if your student thinks according to different patterns, it's very, very difficult to give them feedback because they just don't know what you're trying to do. And you can't do it on their behalf. You can't tell them, this is the way a hypothesis should be stated. Do this one. They've got to develop it themselves. So you can guide them, but you can't tell them. So it's a very time constraining. So we're trying to get it faster, and we're trying to deal with resource efficiency. If you're supervising master students or doctoral students one by one, there's certain conversations that everybody has over and over and over. It's about the same. You can close your eyes, and you know that you're going into sound bit numbers, so many, that you typically get out at this point of the study. And it's what you do. You have to do that. But we're trying to get some of these things out so that it's done collectively to everybody at the same time. But more than that, we're trying to make it easier to give formative feedback. Now, those of you in your own study, how quickly, and I prefer some people to keep their mouth shut, how quickly did you get feedback from your supervisor? If you handed the document in, how long did it take?
3 months.
2 weeks. 2 weeks, if you're lucky. Oh, okay. I mean, I think you were also in a very, very unfortunate position here. But it is a long time, and it's a painful process because you've got to read and wade through pages and pages of written things, and then afterwards you have to find out ways to explain that actually I can't follow what you're writing, or it doesn't meet the requirements. So part of the resource efficiency is also then trying to make it possible for people to condense certain aspects of their thoughts through the process so that you can effectively give feedback on that. And afterwards, they can string the words together and put it together in a narrative format. So we're trying to make students distill certain thoughts and then to phrase them. The other thing, how do you learn about supervision?
From your supervisor.
From your supervisor. Who has learned about supervision? Supervision is, in fact, a scholarly area that people spend there's a lot of development. But what you learn, and it's called a private space, because it's the kind of thing that you go and you acquire that from your supervisor. If your supervisor was particularly good and effective, then you become particularly good and effective. If your supervisor was particularly horrible, you can either become horrible or very good in response to how bad you've had the experience. But you learn, and you often find that you learn only what your supervisor can do, and you're very uncomfortable with other forms of research and supervising other forms of research. And one treats it not as a profession, but as a trade. So basically, you learn it from your apprentice, you learn it, and then it's a trade that you can apply. But it doesn't become a profession, you don't engage in it, and you don't discuss it. And it's very, very difficult, especially if you're a new supervisor, to go to somebody that has supervised for a while and say, now, actually, how do we do this? Because then you admit that you don't know. And that's quite embarrassing, isn't it? So it's very difficult, but this communities of practice and this discussion where people can discuss certain things is very, very important. And it's very essential if you want to take supervision to the level that it is actually a very, very important process. Now, our postgraduate students tend to be the biggest deliverer of research outputs. Who of you have written a paper that didn't involve either student work or where you were a student? Okay. One or two?
One.
Okay. But it's very difficult to do. Your students is the way that you push out those papers. At certain times you co-publish with them. At certain times you use the research they've done, or you work together in various forms. And that is basically the way that you deliver. So it's very important from that perspective. How much does the university get for every doctorate that it produces within the minimum time? Sorry? It's more than that. Much more than that. It's about 700. Per successful within time. And every year that you do it longer, you get less money. And the same for masters. For masters, it could be, it's lower down, 250, it can actually even be lower if you do a limited scope masters. So this funds a lot of your own research activity, your own overseas trips, all of those things. And I don't know if you actually have an incentive scheme of that you get awarded something if you have successfully completed.
Okay. So if you publish.
If you publish, not for supervision. Some places do that as well. And our biggest challenge is around massification. For those of you that are interested in it, there's a 2010 ASIF report on doctoral studies, where it really talks about the challenges and the need to increase the production of doctorates and the production of research students, which is lovely. You can massify it, but are you going to massify it and just send out people that are not quite at the level that they should be? But are you going to do responsible massification? So a lot of these processes are dealing with responsible massification, trying to make it possible to send out people, but making sure they meet the requirements as well. There's different roles. In this whole process, there's a very specific role that the student has to take. The student has to actually engage with the process and do the assignments. It's very simple. There's no ways that you're going to get anywhere if you don't do that. And we've actually made the assessment plan so that they get continuously assessed summatively. So 50% of where the marks go is before they even handed in the proposal. So there's a whole system that you're trying to incentivize that. But a student can't do that at all if he doesn't have the opportunity to discuss it with his supervisor and to engage with his supervisor. This process provides overall feedback, overall systems and processes, etc., but it doesn't actually provide the detailed feedback about the specific topic and area that the student is working on. I might be fairly literate in most, but I'm not at the cutting edge. I also have some responsibilities, and we can go through that. When anybody wants to attend any one of these classes on a Thursday, mostly on a Thursday, and we're also doing one this Saturday, you're free to do so. Okay, you're welcome to do so. On Saturday, for example, we're going to do workshops on how to read academic papers, strategies to deal with academic papers. And it's very interesting because we teach, everybody is working to make it easy for people to read. And if you look at the ways magazines are laid out, it's all about this rapid grabbing, eye-catching little bits of information. But academics papers, you don't read that way. Neither do you read them as stories. You have to be able to read them critically, and you have to deconstruct things. So we've developed training issues around that as well. And I get nervous because nobody's saying a thing. Okay.
Okay, so maybe just to add to that, everybody was sent the schedule of the proposal workshops for the students. So if anybody has not received that, please drop me an email, and I will send you that schedule. And as she said, it's maybe Thursday evenings from 5 until 7, and it will be in the F&B auditorium. And then on this coming Saturday, as she said, there's the workshop on the literature review. Yeah. And one of the things which we must discuss towards the end of this session is whether we need another supervisor session and when we can schedule that so that it suits most people.
Okay, there's some underlying principles underlying the process that we're following. And for those of you that are going to the supervision conference next month, at Stellenbosch, we're going to present quite a lot of this process. Fundamental thing is that your outcomes that you get in your proposal development course has to map directly on the requirements of obtaining a degree. You can't develop a course that has certain things, but you're not actually measuring what you're going to measure in the end of your overall process. So it's very solidly mapped, mostly on the NQF, and we will talk about the way that the TUT system works, which is not quite, maps not on the, exactly on the same way, but it's mapped. TUT follows the IMROD system. So it's very solidly mapped, and you're trying to get people ready to achieve those outcomes. It's very systematic, but more than that, we have a traceability. I don't know who of you have received, especially master's proposals. Student arrives, wonderful proposal. Who thought it out? Where does it come from? Who participated in this development? Is that the student's thoughts? Did the student get there? Your proposal is about 30% of your work, at least. But if we don't trace that that person has actually developed that proposal themselves, you don't know. Okay, you don't know how they thought, you have no record of it. And there are cases that students actually have preliminary enrollment at one institution, get a lot of input from the supervisors to the cost of that supervisor, polish up the proposal and take it somewhere else and get a supervisor, and then suddenly they're just not up to the level that you thought they were from the proposal. I think we've all had those little instances that you're really worried about who did it. It's very traceable. We use a lot of scaffolding. In other words, there's hard scaffolding that we actually give a framework to students. Do this, write this, to enable them on how to think. There's also soft scaffolding in the way that we are enforcing formative feedback throughout the process. In some cases, if you have a small enough group or you have a group that you have long enough, what you can do is you can form syndicates that you actually have people before they hand in the assignment to their syndicate members who does peer evaluation. Some of that is to guide the other student in what to do, but most of it works on internalizing the standards. So if you've internalized the standard, students have internalized the standard, they don't have to always come and ask you, is this good enough? They have to know what is required. The assessment is cumulative, meaning that every assessment assignment follows in another, and all of that maps on the final assignment. I'll show that to you now. It's distributed throughout the course. Nobody can hang around and then suddenly at the end of the year pull things together and suddenly pass the course. And it's very explicit and formalized around its formative feedback. Okay. On the handout that we have, the first two pages. Are you? Okay. Okay, now.
Sorry, guys. If there aren't enough, can you please just share?
I have one more that's only the first part of it. Anybody else needs one? Okay.
But what I'll do is, Maria will send it to me electronically, and then I will send it to everybody. So if you can please just share it for now.
Okay. We are also going to load all of the presentations, all of the things on the MyTutor site so that you can actually look at that. And if students tell you what they're going to do, that you actually know what they were told.
Yeah, and also, you can see that we are recording all the sessions. So this session will be made available for you. So those colleagues of yours that couldn't make it, they can watch it afterwards. And we are also recording all the sessions with the students.
Okay, so the first two pages, I'd like, who of you have driven themselves insane by reading the NQF framework?
Me.
Okay, have you actually read? It's very difficult because there's often an instinctive feel about what makes a doctoral document, what makes a master's document, and it's pretty much what you have internalized in your own process. But very often, you start putting too high standards for people, masters. There are some people that do master's dissertations that really, it's very close to doctoral level. And there are people that don't know what you should put in a doctoral document. So the first two pages is just explicitly, I've copied and pasted out of the NQF framework. And it talks about the outcomes that is expected at a level 9, which is a master's, and level 10. So on this side, I've got around the scope of knowledge. We've got the two next to each other. And it's very important to know that a master's student should engage and critique advanced scholarship. Okay? So from a master's student, you cannot expect that they have all the new critically cutting-edge information and they're up to date with what is cutting-edge when they examined. They're not there. They shouldn't be there. But the doctoral student should be have an expertise and critical knowledge in any area at the forefront of that field. So when you examine or evaluate a doctoral student, that person should be at the cutting edge. And ideally, sort of a month or two after the proposal stage, your doctoral student should be ahead of you in that specific area. Okay. So that student should be hunting out and be absolutely on top of the area, unless it's an area that's very, very close to your own specialization. But very few of us have the luxury of having your own specialization and dealing with the teaching load and dealing with everything else. So your doctoral students should be ahead of you. And you should also be able to conceptualize new research initiatives. What that means is that when a person get a doctorate, we don't expect them to, they've done it once. They should be able to do it again. They should know how to do it. The knowledge of how to do a doctorate, how to do this kind of research should be in them. Unfortunately, the knowledge of how to supervise is not actually in it, but you'll see it's actually specified in here. They should be knowledge literate. Once again, current processes to be evaluated by masters and contribution to scholarly debates by doctorate. Method and procedures, and this is quite interesting. If you look at methods and procedures, your master's student should have a command and the ability to do something. They shouldn't have a knowledge of every single research methodology, be able to have fluent discussions on ontology, epistemology, etc. They should know how to do what they are doing. However, your doctoral students should be at least be comfortable around epistemology and ontology and all those things. But that person should contribute and be innovative in design. There's some universities and some areas that they demand innovation in your research design. So your research design cannot be a replication of what somebody else has done. You have to contribute critically in that field as well. Okay. I don't think it's that strong here, but that person must be able to be innovative, apply variation, do what is necessary. Your problem solving, I think it's very important that at a doctoral level it talks about a complex and challenging problem that they have to do and they have to understand about the consequences. But at a master's level, applying specialist knowledge and theory. So the ability to associate in a variety of areas with theory is not really necessary at the master's level. Not explicitly. Ethical issues for those of you that are part of the ethical processes, and I think we're going to have a separate session on that, which is very, very important, is a pain. Who of you are psychologists by training? Okay. Now there's two fields where the people are very, very strong in ethics application. Medicine, obviously, being one of them, with very, very strong requirements coming from the Nuremberg protocols. The Nuremberg trials after the Second World War, very, very strongly enforced. They have a moral obligation to comply. And in fact, except in America, where they've decided that it's too much to ask that people don't treat Africa different from America, they actually comply to the Helsinki protocols as well. So there's very strong area there. The process is to get any research project approved in medical area is a pain in the extreme. Very often, you're unlikely to get a research process approved or a research project approved within a year of applying. And in some areas, a year and a half is more the expectation that you have. And that's a year and a half before you're allowed to collect data. The psychologist, for the same reason, because they're closely aligned, have very, very strong protocols. Okay. And you'll find that the psychologists tend, therefore, because of the protocols, tend to be very, very quantitative, especially the research psychologists, about how they deal with research. But unfortunately, that's not good enough. The funders to universities don't provide funds to an institution that has any chance of having any research done that's not ethical. So for any funding, no matter what your area is, for international funding and for a number of other funding, you have to have ethical processes everywhere. And we want to deal with those processes and making sure that the students have an understanding with, about that. I know of people that started with their doctorate about 6 years ago, didn't have requirement for ethical processes, ethical clearance. At the moment that the thesis was handed in for examination, they refused to examine it unless there was ethical clearance. And it's not very easy to get retrofit ethical clearance, because then suddenly the ethical committee could demand changes in your protocol, could demand changes in your instruments, everything. So you may end up having to redo quite a bit. And you never know when the university decide that, sorry, no dissertation, no thesis is going out for examination until such time as it's got ethical clearance. There's a whole lot about processing of information. It's difficult. I know that comprehensive universities and technical universities, technologies, really struggle quite a lot with their students' ability to read. That's a pretense. In fact, it is at every single university. If, especially if you sit with people that are doing a master's degree and they've been away for a year or two, they're not quite, they don't read. I mean, there are people that have abnormal habits and actually have little articles in their handbags at all time for them to read if they stand around in queues. I've never been normal, so I do have a lot of them, especially on supervision at the moment, where we're dealing with some of the issues. But that's not the way students work. But that's the way you expect a doctorate student to behave, isn't it? Overall, that's what you expect it to do. You read for a specific degree. And it's very difficult to get those habits in. It's very difficult for people to understand how to search. When I started doing research, we were taught how to find literature. The challenge at the moment is how to filter literature. Because there's just so much available, how do you find what is appropriate? And of course, as you go on and on and on, it gets even more tense. You want a master's student to have a strategy and to have a comprehensive review. So what that means is that that specific student have to have a very good understanding of what is happening in a specific field. But if you want to look at what a doctoral student have to do, they have to deal with incomplete information. They have to deal with analysis and synthesis around information. So the level there is not only to have a comprehensive knowledge, but to actually deal with another layer in your knowledge creation process. And that difference one should internalize, and you should also deal with that in your proposal development. Producing communications, the standard TUT, this next one, producing communicating information, standard at TUT is at least one article published, isn't it? Okay. At a proposal level, one of the requirements that's sometimes enforced is that you have to have a dissemination strategy. Within your proposal, you have to propose how you're going to go about publishing. And any student that is really applying their mind should be able to milk at least 3 papers out of their final thesis.
Okay. We have that in our proposal.
Yeah. So that is very, and fortunately, depending on what the stage of the student is and the specific co-authorship protocol, that means that it's 3 papers for you as well. Okay. So it's really, really important to work on that part. And very interesting, if you look at the second page, and I would like you to look there, For doctoral student, you require them to be able to communicate with non-specialized audiences as well. So if you start looking at them, colloquiums, talking to a variety of other non-specialized areas and being able to communicate is essential. You find that a lot of doctoral students can only talk in the rarefied field of their own specialization, and they're not able to translate it into so that other people can also understand it, and it is a requirement. Systems, simple, management of learning. Okay. Specifically in management learning, what is the requirement at the end of qualification is what's important. A lot of people are resistant to using scaffolding because they say a student should be able to do it on his own. That's about the same as saying that a first year student should be able to do what a third year student should be able to do. It's exactly the same process. The requirements talk about what a person is capable and able to demonstrate at the end of the qualification. So providing scaffolding in the beginning is not against anything. And in fact, one of the other things is I suffered, you should suffer as well. Okay. You find that very often in supervision practices, you know, you've got to find it, you've got to find it. And it's very difficult for students. You don't want to tell them what to do, but you have to guide them about how to do that. Accountability. You'll see that we've got Turnitin processes in the process so that you have students go through Turnitin so that we don't have embarrassing end steps somewhere. Anybody want to say anything about that? And I would like you to please participate in that. The conversations typically go as follows. These new guys don't know what is expected at a master's. At our level, a master's should you should at least be dealing with some new knowledge. Anybody heard it or said it? Okay. That's not true. It's not true at all. And you're actually putting the barriers for a person too high, and you're making it very difficult for a person to complete a master's. Of course, you will find the master's candidates that do that. Those are the guys that get 80%. Those are the guys that are definitely going to do their doctorates. But you don't need to have new knowledge to pass a master's degree.
I think it's all about that one has to realize what is 80% and what is 50%. And so we need to calibrate ourselves and we need to say, okay, what is 50%? And then obviously you're going to have students that do better than that.
Okay. Who joined in the last 5 years? Anybody else? Do you think that the way you evaluate a student is exactly the same as the way anybody else does it? Do you think there's any internal consistency in the way it's done within departments?
No.
What happens? Students choose either the easy way out. You know, if I do my master's in this guy, this is the way to do it. Okay. Or your key students don't ever get there. When do you discuss what is expected at the level? If you look at your faculty committee, who sits on that faculty committee looking at your proposals?
Okay. Some of us here.
Some of you sit here. Is there any form of consistency in what's presented?
No.
Okay. Remember, a proposal is only presented after a supervisor is happy with it. So that proposal, the fact that you accept it, means that you've accepted it. And that means that there may be a variety of levels that people believe that a proposal is good at. And it is necessary to go through a really thorough workshop on this area to go through and actually illuminate it. It's difficult to say when people are sitting here and it's not yet comfortable to say that I think this is what a student needs to have done. There's some ways you do this. Colloquiums is one of the ways. So you have your master's students or in a smaller area, or your doctoral students in the whole faculty presenting. And when they present, you have three of them presenting and then they leave and you have a buns out fight. in the middle, where people discuss it. And that is probably the area where you learn the most about supervision, if you look at the critique of what other people will say. You don't have to actually say anything, but you're hearing the debate. And you're slowly becoming part of that community of practice. And that is probably one of the best ways to get a standardized and a higher level of expectations, because people start driving each other up to higher levels. There's always this tiny bit of competitiveness as well. Although your students' work is not a reflection of you, it's a reflection of what you believe the standard should be. And that's very, very, very important. Now, if you look at that and you see this, what does the TUT expectation sit? And what I have here is the next two is the actual expectations or the schedules that's handed out to external examiners to evaluate a document. If you look, and I'm going to do the thing that I normally do with students, is I'm going to select themselves, or I will select you, to talk to me. How will you look at the contextualizing of a problem? What do you think shows a good contextualizing of a problem? What shows a good contextualizing? You've been guiding students. When are you happy when they've contextualized it? Your hand is halfway up, so I get. Okay, that is a process of developing your development. But what provides a context? What is a context? Okay. What's the larger discipline, and what's the relevance, the actual relevance in practice of it? And you read master's proposals, even doctoral proposal, they start on the equivalent is when it was dark in the beginning. Okay. The way it's phrased is before 1994. What does this have to? In some cases, it's a very important part of the context. In some cases, it's got zip all to do with the context. So what is it that provides the context? And how can you guide and how can you assess if the only thing that you have is look at contextualization? Now you evaluate this and you're trying to give marks to it. Is it okay or is it not okay? And then the same thing around something called justification of a project. One of the big challenges at universities of technology and some of the comments of universities is about practice-driven research. Now, I firmly believe in MOTU, in practice-driven research, and the fact that it is definitely at a doctoral level. But there are people that don't agree with it. So what is the justification? And especially if you're struggling in the beginning, a lot of your students struggle to understand that that justification is not only from practice. You've got to substantiate it in practice, but you also have to substantiate it in the literature, in the theoretical framework, or you can't argue forward. So you read proposals, and I do read a lot of doctoral proposals that people put together at various universities, and you'll see that they've only argued it from a practice point of view. Okay. Or some people on the other side, you don't get it a lot in management, but specifically in engineering and science, you get people that substantiated it in the blue sky somewhere up there and has no understanding of the consequence or where it's related. And if you look at the NQF outcome around context and systems, it actually requires you to know of what the consequences of what you are developing is going to be. So it has a very high, all of these have very high levels. It tells you the weighting and it tells you what you're going to look at. But unless we engage deeply, and that's something that needs to come from everybody, deeply with what is meant by this. You cannot, I think standardized is an extreme word, because you can't really standardize over the faculty, but you cannot norm your expectations. And norming is essential if you want to start driving out a high volume, and it's essential when you want to bring in new academics quickly. Now for the guys, okay, you've recently joined them. What did you know what was expected for, of a master's document from the start? What is expected here of a master's document? Yeah. It makes sense. It sense, but it's very difficult to evaluate when it's at such high level.
What will make 10 marks? How will I give 10 marks from these three?
Okay.
So, and the other thing is, I want to give this to students as well. So this is the template which is for marking. Nobody gives them. They are driven in the dark until, so they don't know what instruments they are being examined. That's another gap area.
It is. Who of you in your process of those of you that have hunted down the doctorate thing? Okay, and it is hunting down sometimes. It's very painful.
What happens is we have seen some MBA dissertations which have been examined with this template.
Yeah.
There is huge discrepancies between the two examiners. One failed, another gave distinction, and we put our head like this. We can't argue because he is an examiner. So essentially I'm saying is this needs more clarity and more contextualization for all of it.
And the norming.
Starting from the format. Even format is debatable at TUT.
Okay. Okay, this is we're going to and we have to discuss this. But everybody has to be part of it. When we're looking at the final examination before they go to the faculty committee, students are going to be expected to present. Okay? And everybody is welcome to in that assessment. Anybody that's welcome is going to be able to do part of the assessment panel and see what it is. And that part of that is around that norming, about what is expected. And sometimes you know what you're looking for. I mean, we all know what we're looking for, but can you articulate it? And don't you sometimes, I mean, insecurity is another characteristic of most academics. That's why we publish so much. We have this deep fundamental thing that I don't know everything. I know I don't know everything. So there's this hunt always. Are you absolutely sure you are at the right level? So that norming is also has to be done as effectively as possible. You disagree with me?
The issue here is TUT has built up certain procedures and norms, and they're not willing to move.
No, I don't think you need to move. I'm going to show you how I've done this to try and make it work at it. And the next two pages is in fact that. There is description of outcome. It's page number 5 and 6. If you don't have page 5 and 6, I have got no doubt in my ability to lose papers while I'm photocopying. What I've done here is I've used a really extensive rubric that we used, and I've articulated the way it's against the assignments and where it maps onto the IMRAD system. Because it doesn't really look at it one-on-one. One of the ways that you make assessment easier is if you associate a specific chapter with a certain bit of assessment. If you're assessing an 80-page, 100-page, 200-page document, how do you know at the end what level to give? Because there's a whole thing about recency. What do you remember? Do you remember the last bit? And the conclusion is pathetic. So you think the whole document is pathetic, but you've forgotten what happens in the beginning. So it's easy to do it like that. So what we've done on the problem statement, and you'll see this repeatedly. In fact, you'll be using this repeatedly when you look at your candidate's work, is looking at within the, is the context clearly specified? Is the problem defined? Is it substantiated empirically? In other words, have you got things from practice, evidence that it is really a problem, or is it something so theoretical that it is utterly irrelevant? There are fields where people do that, but in management, it's unlikely that you're going to do that. Is the rationale clear? Is the aim clear? Is the utility in domain? And is the awareness of ethical, and then is the contribution explicit? Now, this is the master's document. If you go to the next two, which is on page, you'll see seven, you'll see that there are extra things in there. So what I've done here is I've separated the doctoral document and the master's document slightly, but in the assignments, it's a single assignment with certain factors. For example, in the doctoral level, you're required to contribution to knowledge clearly identified and substantiated. So this maps onto, if you're doctoral level, onto your introduction A, and it maps in your contribution to new knowledge. The research questions, where we have a very, very solid process that we put students through in order to make them develop and engage with the question and structure it into things that need to be answered in literature, things that need to be answered in, through investigation, assumptions and limitations. It talks to your introduction, it talks to your logical development. And a lot of that is around how you analyze so that you make it easy for a person to develop, articulate, and argue. And it talks about methods. Literature survey, and you'll see that there's two things. We make students do a literature survey, which is a second assignment, where they have to read and actually engage with a variety of papers. I think the requirement that I have at least 20 to 30 in the first stage, but in the final, I expect 50 of a doctoral candidate and at least 30 of a master's candidate. Okay. Anybody feel unhappy about this?
No, it's very right. What I would say is literature review is the part of the starting point for most of the students. Yeah. I have developed a template for literature review, I will show you.
Okay.
It applies across that, whether MBA, MTech, or MSc.
Okay.
Most of the things are same. I give them before, then they do the literature review, they come back, they mark themselves.
No, they don't. This is one of the fun things. What we do when we train syndicates, we give them previous assignments, previous people, and we make them assess. And what we've been finding with the master's guys is typically they're harsher than the lecturers were.
We have seen they give direct marks only on non-formatting environment.
Okay.
Which means what I'm saying is they don't understand.
One of the
As you say, finding the gap in the literature, the student doesn't understand what that means.
Okay, I will. When we talk about the assignments, we'll go through what I expect them to do to get there. But one of the requirements of literature, and there is literature on how to do literature reviews. It's very difficult to search for them because running a search on how to do a literature review gets you all the literature reviews. But you can get it, and I've got quite a basis of that now. But typically, it really goes down to the fact that your literature review is, in fact, a research project on its own. It has to have a methodology. It has to have questions that you're driving it. There's a way that you're structuring it, and we've got a very formalized, the notes will be on getting students to do that. Okay? And it is the heart. If the literature review is not sound, you're going nowhere with the masters, and you're not going anywhere with the doctors.
Because I find, Ria, that I know what a good literature review is, but to teach a student to do a good literature review is a challenge. And I'm hoping that you're going to help us with that.
I'll put it through. And it is. In fact, if you look at the whole process, of developing these guidelines, it falls into a science area of design science. We say there's a practical problem. Now go and engage with practitioners. You do, this is a lot of case study analysis and a lot of action research in developing these things. So a lot of this is a product of a really intense research project that some people were part of the problem formation, how to guide them, and some people were actually in trying to get that. And it's difficult, because supervision is pretty much like teaching. You if you know something, you only know it if you can teach somebody else it. And it's not, if you can do something, it doesn't mean that you can teach it. I mean, all of you know that. You can do it, but how do you actually break it down so that you can teach it? How can you go? Yeah. Yeah. It's, you get this public, this absolutely public embarrassment of being said you're not good enough. It's very bad. So we've broken it up into two exercises. We make them do a survey, and then we make them do the analysis of the question. And after that, they can then do a literature review. So we help them to structure processes that get them to critically review literature, because he said so, and then she said, and then she said, and somebody else said, what about it? How do you engage with it? How do you compare with it? So that is very important, and we do that in two separate assignments. We do it in assignment 2 and assignment 4. At a doctoral level, in your literature review, it's essential to identify the gap. Okay. But people struggle with that. The research design, assignment 5, we make people do a conceptual design, and we're trying to engage with that. And what we've done in the research design is an incredible list, and I've got the doctoral one in front of me, of factors that we want you to take into account. So we've basically driven here, and this is also developed, what is it that you look for? What is acceptable? Okay. So proposed research plan, which is part of your logical, and your presentation, which is part of your format. Now we're going to give the people the template that is used by the university, and we're going to have some discussions around that, and I think one of the things is going to be actually talking about it through the various learning processes so that we can discuss, and where is this not working? Where is the way that the format has been developed absolutely true for one form of research, but not really good for adapting to any other form of research? So if you do this kind of research, these headings are perfect. Any other research, maybe not. So, and we need to get that, and it's not about trying to change it from one angle, it's about forming a community of practice, discussing that, and then adjusting it to be appropriate based on what the community of practice are developing. So a lot of this is also about developing it. So, I think it's very difficult because mostly we don't have common agreement in any one university, not even in any one faculty, and sometimes not in any one school or department. So it's getting a university-wide, but the supervision is an area that, as I said, that a lot of research is being done on, and there's active research done on that, and part of it is trying to get that, but most of all, because it's such a private space, in most practice areas, people don't talk about it. So every time you engage with it, you feel as if you're comparing yourself to some medical standard. And it's very difficult to set standards. No, the NQF doesn't have the template. This is aimed to be the basis of a guide. It will be very scary if this assessment is the same next year round. Okay. We need input from people about what it is that you specifically look. If people look at other factors, we need that. If something isn't clear, we need to know that. Because this thing has to develop. and it has to develop in something that can provide guidance to students, to supervisors, and to external evaluators, so that they can have something that can norm them. In one of the cases that we've worked with master students, after 1 year in the second loop of implementing that, the difference, the maximum difference between two different lecturers marking was 15%. And that was because the one lecturer came in and joined 6 months before. So that norming process. After a year or second loop, these things people evaluate. They know exactly, they have a common understanding. And it's not easy to have that. It's very difficult, you know, if I say, okay, what makes a handsome man? Okay. Everybody's got his own requirement. But women will sit together and we'll factor out what is important. And in this community of females, we'll certainly put his ability to think, his ability to reason, and his willingness to deal people with females with intelligence fairly high up in the list. But when you start talking about what it is, then we can say whether somebody is handsome or not. And I can say, you know, for me, it's really, really important that the person must be able to talk. Not just use words, but talk. Okay? And you start standardizing around that. And women do that all of the time. And I'm sure men also do that, but their standards are pretty shallow. It's just this by. That's a doctoral expectation. So what we've done, or what I've done here, is as a first round, I have articulated the outcomes for this course. So specifically, at the end, we want students to be able to do the following. They should be able to define and substantiate a complex problem. They should be, the D level, some of these, that a specific outcome is only for the people at D level. They should identify the knowledge gap. They should be able to develop research questions or hypotheses. If there are some of you that insist that everything declares it's a crocodile and BI hypothesis, please let me know. If there are people that prefer working with propositions, also let me know. There are different forms. Okay. Personally, there's nothing different. I get very, very tense about doing anything, either quantitatively or qualitatively. I'm a mixed method person myself, because any one is a single view, but that's my background, it's my training. And in various disciplines, there are different ways of doing it. And various supervisors have different preferences in the way they supervise. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to get to a generic process that you can get to a research question that you can then put into the form of a hypothesis. It's basically what it is. So some of them will be developing hypotheses, some of them won't. They have to get a logic argument and they have to be able to present that. I think the bit that is the most discomforting is when people do a lot of research, they identify this rough proposal, they get a lot of data, and then they try to write it up. Then actually what you do is this, I've got this, I've got this, I've got this. How can I put these things that I have together in an argument? Not how can I build the argument, but what do I have to build the argument with? And you really want to be able to gather information to support an argument. They should have an appropriate understanding of the current knowledge, literature review, and then they should be able to execute and report on the literature review. Now, one of the reasons students and a lot of examiners focus on the format of referencing when they look at the literature review is that's what they know. Okay. So if you're examining a literature review and you're not on cutting edge, what can you say about that literature review? In fact, there's a lot that you can say. You can talk about the way it's been structured. You can see how it's argued. You can clearly see if a person has engaged critically. You can clearly see if they've done synthesis around that. But you can't give the detail. But if you don't have those standards, if you don't know how to look for them, you look at the way they've done referencing, because that's what you can do. Okay? Appropriate research design. we're not going to get to the end of the protocols, we're not going to get to the end of the instruments, they are going to have some indication of it. They need some indication of it to start working on the ethical application, and you will have to spend a lot more time in actually getting those instruments properly developed and getting the protocol properly developed. For those of you in certain fields, the protocol talks about, I am going to try and see what students think about food. Okay. Now, I can go out and I can go to some of those guys that I see come with their own food and can ask them what they think about the university's food. Or I can actually say, I'm going to randomly sample. This is the way I'm going to do that. This is the way I'm going to select them. I'm going to give them the informed information and consent, and you give it step by step. So we're going to request that the students start developing those as well, because your research design, I don't know who of you have tried to read some research design, unless you know what the student was trying to say. There's not a way that you can actually follow what they were trying to do, because they
hire a statistician.
They put it together. They hire a statistician in the end. Is that a research design? That's part of the analysis. And what gets me, myself, personally tense is when people say about analysis, I'm going to use SPSS. So tell them, okay, and you're going to use a pink pencil. What form of analysis are you going to do on SPSS? What things are you going to do on Atlas? Don't tell me I'm going to use SPSS, because all that I'm going to do is I'm going to take my little file over to the statistician, and they're going to make it. They're going to jump on. You can just as well say, I'm going to use a statistician to design my instrument, I'm going to use a statistician to do my analysis, etc. And the level to what a statistician should be involved with is also a very problematic area. I know there's a lot of them that don't mind being heavily involved because they get paid well. A lot of the people that provide services in universities feel that the supervisors put a heck of a load on them, because the supervisors don't know how to design an instrument either. So they just come with some idea, and miraculously, the statistician will help with this instrument. It will be developed perfectly. And then whatever comes out, the supervisor will know what to do with incomplete data. Explicitly identified as something that you have to be able to do. Okay. So what are you going to do there? We want them to have a data gathering strategy, a data analysis strategy, not the detail around that. They have to have a plan. They have to have the initial ethics application. We want them to be able to communicate academically. This is another area that there's a heck of a lot of discourse and arguments and debate at the moment, is whether, to what extent is a language editor allowed to work on a document? Because language is the way that you formulate and articulate your thoughts. If you've just put these thoughts together and somebody massaged them into a reasonable argument, is that support, or is that actually doing your thinking for you?
You must read again.
It doesn't matter if you must read again. That's one thing, because they don't understand. But sometimes they do so much that they literally do the right thing. They're changing it into wonderful words and changing it into beautiful arguments, but it's not your work, is it? Mm-hmm. So there's... Yeah, they don't engage with it again. Now, who of you, if you close your eyes and I ask you what's the biggest problem with students? Language. Who of you don't think that language is among the biggest problem with students? And yourself? No, language is a particularly bad problem. And
let me put it differently. For the starters, it's the academic writing, not the language per se.
Yeah.
No.
But it's language to start off with. Language, whether it's used in understanding what you read, language, whether it's used to argue, language, whether it's used to put it together into academic writing, language is actually present in a number of areas. So language is fundamental. Then comes from language, they can't read. And a lot of us can't read either, but that's a by the way. The next one is they can't write because they don't know what to write. You tell them, have you looked at a student's eyes when you tell them, put two pages together and send it to me so I can look at it? What do you see? Panic, hysteria, nervous.
Okay, give me the table. Write abstract, author.
Yeah, but that's
objectives, outcome, but that's, sample size. Do only those two pages.
But that's what we're doing. We're forcing them to bring those thoughts out that they can then phrase around. We're trying to teach them how to read, a strategy for reading.
But I mean, even if you ask in this room over here, who is English first language speakers? Or who are the English first language speakers?
Whose language is first? Just shut up. Whose language? This is wonderful. One person in here is a first language English person. Okay. Who of you teach comfortably in English? You've learned. Yeah, sometimes it's not that comfortable because you're trying to find a precise word and you just get it. You can teach in English. There's nothing that you can't teach, but what's your comfort levels?
Especially people coming from engineering backgrounds.
Don't talk about them. Don't talk about them.
Don't insult us.
Don't be ugly. It's close to my heart, that's my family, you know, and there's some families that you don't want to talk about this family members. You just want to keep them. So those are my family members. I don't want to discuss them in public. Okay. Then reflective practice. You will see in there, they are required to reflect quite regularly. One of the things we're going to make them do tomorrow, and once again, you're perfectly welcome to sit in and see what it is I'm going to give them documents to fill, which we do an academic literacy test. And it's very effective to start off by making people understand how little they know. Okay. Also as a benchmark to see what it is. So we're going to put the academic literacy test in front of them, and we're going to give them a reflective, some issues to reflect on. They have to, for among other things, they have to state what the expectations are, where the limitations are, and we do self-efficacy tests on them to see, basically, to just know where they believe, and we do that at the end as well to see to what extent. One thing that's not in here, but you'll see explicitly in your assessment plan, is the assessment of the overall program. So we're doing programmatic assessment on this as well. And we need input to make sure that this thing works.
So how many students can we expect to deregister after tomorrow night?
I don't think so. I am very accessible. I work on showing people my broom and look really bad and mean, and they believe it for a while.
The other question is, how practical is to give the students the rubrics for assessment?
I'll show you how I do that. It's quite. It
works. My understanding is they're not supposed to know, but I think.
No, this rubric, I'll tell you this. Assessment.
Exact ones which we send to examiners. That is the standard they should know.
Assessment, assessment theory, assessment practices tells you that unless you've told somebody what they must do, they will never be able to do it. How must they guess it? Must they smell it?
It should be in the public domain. Look, this is an unchecked assessment criteria.
Okay, I'll show you how I'm doing that. Okay, and in fact, what I want you to do is to look at the next page, which I must just find here. The ethic. We'll get to the ethic rubric. The set of documents that looks like this: assessment plan. It's about 3 pages onwards in your pack. I'll get to the ethics as well. It looks something like this. Okay. What you have there, you can't see, read there. On the top here, where's the pointy thing? on the top here is the outcomes. So if you look at that document, you'll see the outcomes are put 1, 2, 3, 4 in a row there. And down the side is the assessments we're going to do. So you'll see that they are going to be assessed at various points. But you'll also see that all of these are formative. Even your final assessment will be formative, as we will be giving feedback to the students so that they can continue to improve. So we've got formative assessment very fundamentally into the process. There's one that looks at doctoral level, you see that it's very bright, and the second one has got big stars. It's not for everybody. So we're going to do the academic literacy, the reflection. Then they're going to do assignment one, which is formulating a problem statement. That maps, and as it goes through, I see it's... there's something... it's not perfect. Okay. That is not fully occupied. That's not the right block here. But you've got it in here. Well, I don't know what's happened there. In fact, these ones are supposed to be crossed in everything. I'll get the right copy. Somehow I must have printed the wrong thing. These things are supposed to have blocks everywhere. So each one of these assessments assess certain things, but at the end it assess everything. This thing is unfortunately not right. And when you're doing summative assessment, the student has already had formative assessment on every single one of those blocks. As I said, my crosses weren't, I don't know why my crosses weren't bad, I must have not saved the right one. Okay, so the assessment plan is very, very intense. It maps on the outcomes, and it makes sure it's systematic, it's cumulative, so you assess something, and then you assess it again, so that they at least have one loop of formative feedback before they're summatively assessed. And then in the end, and these things count for different marks. If you look down the right inside, that I see is complete. You'll see that the first assignment is 5%, the second assignment is 5%, third 10%, 10% and 5%. So in your assignments themselves, a lot of the marks go, and those you will be assessing and you will be marking and awarding the marks. You'll be given, I'm not going to go around and say, listen, this student that you think is really cool is worth a zero. I'll give you my assessment, but I'll give you my assessment. Okay? And I will be measuring on exactly the same standard consistently all the time. So you will get a consistent feedback. If you have a disagreement or want to discuss it, please talk to me. My cell number will be available to you, not to the students, okay? Just so that I can sleep. And you can contact me at any time. If there's anything that you want to discuss where you have a different understanding.
Will you give this to students?
I'll show you. The handout to the students consists of the following. The handout I'm going to give them tomorrow consists of the assessment plan and the next documents, which says assignment one, there's a rubric. Assignment two, there's a rubric. Assignment three, there's a rubric. So the students will be given both the assessment plan. They won't be given the assessment strategy, but they'll be given the assessment plan. One of the things that is quite worthwhile is looking at that final one that actually has to have crosses across as well. It's a presentation. Students will be presenting their proposals, and they have to be able to argue that. And then there's a panel that will be assessing that. We'll have standardized rubrics. The students will also know what they're being assessed on. And if there's 20 people at that point in time, 20 people are going to assess, and we're going to average out of 20 people's assessment. Okay. So everybody is part of the assessment at all times. The final research proposal, I will assess and you will assess, or we'll get double assessments on that depending on the volume, so that there's two assessments on that. There will be a discussion on that so that we are not going to average on those. We're going to agree on those so that we come to some understanding there. But by that time, I think it should be quite quite clear what we...
How do we make sure that the students understand what this means? Because they will come to me. I don't understand what they mean by this.
I am going to sit with them, and I am going to talk to them, and you will have the documented evidence of what I've said to them. So if you...
That is very important, because they will come to me and say, I don't understand what you are, why you have detected this, I never did.
No, but we will talk to them and we will explain. They are specific in the classes. When we hand out an assignment, I will be dealing with the theory underneath it. I will be explaining what they have to do and how to do that and what is it that we're looking for. So that will be, it's totally transparent, that part of it.
And also the recordings will be available to the students as well.
Yeah.
So if they didn't understand it the first time, they can always go back and look at it again.
Okay. Now, the ethics application is not going to be the final ethics application. What I need you to look at is the two blocks that are hard-lined, okay, solidly. This rubric you'll see is quite extensively developed, and that is a rubric that's used within a school to do the initial, to do the assessment. According to the rules at WITS, the assessment that anything has to pass the school's clearance. So this is what has been looked, and you'll see that in the assessment forms I always have this unacceptable where you can rate. You can't just say, give a mark to it. You have to say in everything where it is. So this rubric goes to all the students, but it's also used to assess what is in there. So let's look at it, and it's been developed specifically to address very, very generic issues. All the issues are in there. So some of those may not be applicable to a specific student, but they should consider them, and they should formally consider them. The first thing, I get really tense if people talk about ethical issues and they say they've got informed consent. What is the ethical issue? It's not informed consent, that's the answer. Okay. So what is it that are ethical issues within the proposals? Have they clearly been identified? Are the student aware of what's in there? Student and supervisor. First thing deals with harm to a third party. So if you look at what is named Annexure B on the first page, there are in the beginning of the third page, or the second page, you'll see the exact questions that the student must be able to answer. So, for example, does this research discriminate? And if so, what have you done to do that? In fact, what I'd make students do in the end is to give me a summary document on top of the proposal and refer to exactly where in the document have they addressed that. I have done this and this, refer to page so-and-so. So we want to be able to trace it. You don't want to spend hours and hours and hours waiting for a pack of documentation trying to work out what on earth is going in there. And if you guide students as to what to consider, if you guide supervisors what to consider, it makes it much easier. Who of you have yourself gone through an ethical application? Okay. How easy is it? It's it is very, very, very difficult because we don't really, all the information you get about ethics talks about certain things. It doesn't tell you what process you go through to consider it. It doesn't tell you what could possibly be issues. So we're going to do that workshop as well, and we're probably going to have a separate session on ethics for all the supervisors because I think that needs to be discussed quite extensively. The second lot that we want to know is if they, is there participation in services, or in other words, are you rendering a service to a community that they've been part of and you're taking it away? The last one is around, the next one is about conflict of interest. very often that's not been addressed properly. Is there a conflict of interest between the student and the supervisor? Who's funding that research? May they somehow require a specific angle on the research findings? And all of those things have to be explicitly dealt with. And the final one, we find that students very, and even people that do their own research, very often ignore. I know of one person that did a doctorate recently that worked on the built environment but worked on the design of prisons. Okay, so part of her research was done through interviewing people in maximum security prisons, including people that they say ahead of time, don't worry, he won't be able to bite you. Because that person is in there because they ate people. Okay. Or so you're sitting there, or you talk to somebody that hasn't spoken for 8 or 9 years, and suddenly they start speaking, and they burst out in tears. It's incredibly traumatic for the researcher. And very often you don't understand, you go and you do certain things, and you might be doing something that causes emotional damage on you. How are you dealing with that? And in a number of areas, and specifically the area of the discipline that this development's come from is from engineering, from occupational health and safety perspective, and from anthropology. Because the anthropology researchers also has a slight danger that they might end in a big pot or whatever, so if you characterize it. So there's a lot of harm. And the part that people neglect in ethical assessment is the potential harm to the researcher. So we've got a very formalized process that we put the students through. There's formalized things that they have to address. And in the end, we want to have a document with overall what the document will consist. It will have an overall summary. It will have the full proposal. And it will have detail around these separate annexures that just give the information.
Maybe just to say that, I don't know if all of you are aware of it, but we are at the moment expected to create a faculty research ethics committee. And so some of us sitting here have been seconded to this committee. And I think that this is probably a good starting point. We're going to go through the ethical training for TUT, but as the research committee, we will have to decide how we are to deal with it. And this is maybe a good starting point for us to start talking about the templates and so on. But I think that we would like another workshop like this with supervisors specifically on the ethics. And at the moment we're looking at April the 12th.
Yeah.
So the 12th of April, which is a Friday afternoon. But I will send you guys an email and we can just agree on whether that will work for everyone.
Can't work for me because I'm getting my PhD thing.
Oh, you're getting your PhD that day. Okay.
That's important. That's a really, really important bit. It's important for everybody. Okay. Time frames. And I've got the time frames again at the very end of the, behind that, this pack. You'll see that it's very, very tight. There are sessions that are on Thursdays, and there are sessions that are on Saturdays on here. The Saturday workshops, there's one around reading of academic literature, with the other one is...
There's
the 13th of April, Ethics in Research. Then there's one at the end, which is the 1st of June, for those of you that haven't booked it out yet, is when we're going to have the detailed assessments. It would be really good, and we will have the program for people so they can try and be there for their own students at least. But you are welcome. So that's going to be at the Saturday. It's going to be fairly intensive. We're going to try and bring people that have been part of such committees before so that we have a wide committee and we will have discussions about that.
So basically, for those of you that haven't understood it yet, The 1st of June is going to be like the DRIC. So we want as many DRIC members as possible at that meeting. And then the 6th of June, and we're probably going to have it the 6th and 7th of June, will then be the FHDC. So all the students will be, it will be a research showcase, but it will just be proposals that the students are presenting. Okay. And the idea is that the students will then be given feedback during those sessions, and by the 7th of June, we've then approved all the proposals.
But it's essential that the feedback that they get on the 1st of June is around making sure they don't embarrass anybody.
Yes.
In public. Okay. So
on the program, we will print the supervisor's name next to the student's name.
And those of you that, it's really terrible. You sometimes, I found that I have on occasion wanted to beat up other members of a panel when they're nasty to my students. I have the right to be nasty to my students. Nobody else has that right. So I get very emotional in such a state. But I think we all do. But so that's going to be important that we do that assessment. And we give the students feedback so that they can go and update. For a lot of students, they struggle around presentation. The document can be perfect, but they really struggle about presenting it in an oral format. Okay? Let's just quickly go, if you want a 5-second break, then I just want to go through the assignments quickly so that everybody... physical, mental break. Okay. I think. Am I okay? Okay. I just want to go through the assessment plan now. The assessment rubrics for everything else will also be available. And the way that I'm putting the things into the study guide is the way these documents are given. So in assignment one, I can also show you, there's a very formal structure. 2-page document with little headings. Give me your problem area, context, fill it in here. Then do the following, what sources you're going to use, etc. So what you will get is you'll get a very standardized way that the students have reported it in and the rubric. What they told is they've got to present the context in which the problem exists. Okay? They've got to substantiate the problem and on the empirical basis. Let me go there. On the topic that you're working. And it will be assessed according to the following matrix. We've discussed that already. You'll see that the one that is in bold and italics is only applicable to doctoral candidates. So this, and you will get a rubric like this, but then with little columns at the end which says not at standard, need some work, acceptable kind of grading that you can just mark where they are and then you give a mark. It makes it very easy if you start assessing according to those for you to be able to give a mark. But then we will also be working with this. If there's a big problem around anything, we will arrange some form of agreement and discussion around that. I'm pretty neurotic about the format that they submit these assignments in. You'll see they all have to be electronic. And if you've tried to work out from 30 or 40 submissions, who belongs to what, so there's explicit file names. What will be done is the students will put that on my tutor, and you will have access to get that document and the rubric and assess that. My rubric will also go to you, and you will then compile a combined rubric and post it so that the students can get it there. So that the typical delay is a week. So the students have to post it on a Monday, or I think it's on a Thursday, and you then have to post back by the following Thursday. It's a very, very, very tight timeline, and they will probably try and see you in between. They have to see you in between and have some conversations as well. The second assignment is a literature survey. And what we have there, it's in the form of an Excel spreadsheet. These are most of, I think I've used some of the things that Marie-Louise used as well. I have extra things that I want to have in. I want students to, per article that they've got, give me the following. They've got to go through the author listed. They have to identify what is the problem that's being looked at in this article, what form of research was taken, what methods were used, what limitations exist around what's been discovered. Now, you're trying to get them to critically engage. And unless they've dealt with whatever that findings, what's the limitations around those findings, what assumptions, what's the context, it's very difficult for people to engage critically. But if you see that these were the findings, but the context is substantially different from the context that you're trying to work in, then you have the basis to start engaging critically with the documents. They also have to link it to their own research, and then they're going to use the TUT Harvard style. Harvard is a very, very interesting name for a grouping of styles. Everyone has its own permutation, but we will try and enforce the brand name TUT on it. Okay.
There's actually
a document. Yeah. Documents. Yeah. No. That one is going to be posted as well. Okay. So the key authors will also be identified. So as a supervisor, you can then go through what authors the student have found, so that you can give feedback. If there's a specific author that you know should be included there, you can tell them, look at this author as well. Okay. So you can do track change on their documents and post that as well if you want to do in that format. People have different ways that they want to do feedback. So you have the electronic track change. You can also take the document and write on it and scan it and post it back. You don't have to type. I write everywhere, and I have this horrible habit of not writing legibly. I have had students that insisted that they wrote my comments down because they can't read mine. Okay. Very important, at this point they have to do 20 to 30 articles. You'll see that the submission date for assignment 2 is after the break, after the Easter break. So we'll be doing the reading this time, and they will be working on assignment 2 concurrently all the time. So they'll have quite a while to be putting this together. Okay. And there's the analysis form, we expect them to have that. The research structuring, it's a very solid format. I can take you through that, but there's not much time now that we put them through a grid. And what they have to do then is in assignment 3, they not only have to give in the assignment, but they also have to give a reflection. Now, one of the things that I insist that students do all the time, you'll see that they have to give in a research journal, is that they have to keep a record. And that's basically a table format where they have to record every bit of feedback that they received. I received this feedback from who, when, and what did I do about it? Because one of the things that's the most painful is if you know you've given that student feedback and he ignored it or she ignored it. So you want to have that record, and you have to sign off physically on that record. So when the students scan it in and post it, it has to be with your comments that you agreed that those were the feedback and that's the way it's been incorporated. What you want to do is you want to train the students to deal with feedback, to consider that feedback and to know what to do with that feedback. Because that is, from formative feedback, this one part is giving it, the other part is them using it. You know, it's very difficult to do that. This is the things that we look on. A scope of delineation, I can't go through the process now, but it's really intense, and they come out with this. So they have to come out with specific framework that they put in their research. We basically start with your research problem, phrase it as a question, and work through the question. What should come out then is what questions need to be addressed in the literature. One of those, obviously, is definitions. what is this? If you have something in a problem, what do I mean with performance? Exact definition with substantiation of that. And then, what assumptions are you making? It's very difficult for students to find the assumptions, but if you've identified what needs to be, things have to be assumed about, it makes it easier. And then what limitations are already inherent in the study based on the way that you have put the scope or things that you have, you are not going to deal with, that you have to state clearly as limitations of the study. The reflection will 20%. Okay. Then there's a literature review. Now, at this point, I've given them a 10-page body. Now, this is very difficult if the total document has to be 12 pages, and we'll probably have to talk about this and find out if we can, in this case, have it extended, that these guys can have a longer version, or if they will have a longer 10-page version of the literature review as an annexure. You know, because you want them to engage this deeply with the literature, otherwise they can't continue or carry on.
So what shall we do? Make it an annexure? And
let
it be 12 pages, but just make it an annexure.
I don't think there's a page requirement. We have put 12 or 15
pages. There's a 12-page requirement in the final submission.
But I think that's sort of the minimum.
No, you said... A thorough one gets about 25 pages, but the problem is that a student that hasn't been guided will find it incredibly difficult to develop 12 pages.
Yeah.
So if you're working on your own, getting up to 12 pages is not easy.
Okay.
Yeah, but some of them are. There's 84 that could avail themselves here, and I think 30 at the moment.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can I just make a suggestion? Would it be possible to ask the HDC? Because otherwise we go through all the travel and we decide and then the HDC say,
Okay.
So I think we must work from the top down.
Okay,
because it's possible.
Yeah, because the thing is, what happens is the proposals get approved by the FHDC,
mm-hmm.
and then they still go to the higher degrees committee.
Yeah. Okay, because the alternative would be that they put a condensed version of the literature review in the main document and have a detail. So there is a full document and there's a shortened version. Okay, but it's, okay. So what we want them to do when they do the literature review, they extend that Excel spreadsheet that they've got already, and they have to then identify concepts that's being addressed in this work, the theories that is in the specific work or that's been used. You very often find students trying to combine findings based on three or four different theories into a single research, where they don't understand that there were some fundamental theories on which this work is it's based, and they are competing theories. So if you start looking at it and you don't force them to actually look at what's the theory underlying, they can't really do any meaningful synthesis, or they do some very false synthesis. And then what's the unresolved issues in that document? The identification of unresolved issues, so this typically given as recommendations at the end of the research, is what often drives doctoral research. Okay. They have to, obviously, the literature survey you'll have again, but now you'll see that the master's guys will have to at least 30 journal papers, preferably, and the doctoral guys 50. Literature review, once again, detail around that, Literature Review is treated as a research project on its own. They have to give a scope. They have to define what they're doing. They have to identify the populations or where they are actually looking at literature, especially if you're looking at multi-discipline work. Again, submitted. Assignment 5 is then just a table, basically where they start, they give the research problem, etc., they redraft it. So by assignment 5, what they give as their research problem will be different from what they've identified in their research problem in the beginning. It should be different. But one of the key indicators of a student's probability of removing themselves from study is if a person starts changing titles. There's a lot of research done on that, that one of the indicators that show problems with completion is changing titles, changing topics. There's certain things that tell you that if a student is not getting settled, it's they're likely to move. So we want them to actually focus it. It may change. And you might find that by assignment 2, they suddenly realize that, oops, I am flogging a dead horse here. And they might be going somewhere else. So assignment 5, which is the last assignment, they literally go through and they restate it. And then in a table, they just have to identify per objective what they're going to do. The reason for this is that students very often think that a single instrument will meet all objectives, or a single process or procedure will meet all the objectives. So you're forcing them to engage per objective. How are you going to do it? What's the strategy you're going to follow? The textbook that I use and that I'm going to recommend to students, unless anybody has desperate differences, at which point they should address and tell me which book they want their students to use, because if you want to get really stressed, emotional trauma, read 3 or 4 research methodology books after another. Okay, the inconsistency of terminology, the direct disagreement is scary. It's very, very scary. So this is at the moment the most robust one for Saunders for management. Okay. Yeah. It's one of the most used. I know that you're getting a desk copy. It's printers. Pearson. And it's just known as Saunders, but it's Saunders, Lewis, and Thornhill. It is really, really.
Now, one thing. If you go to Literature Review, the 30 and 50 articles, I tell them, even at MBA, now those 30 should be cited in the literature. Otherwise, you will find that they produce a list.
I get really tense if people give me a bibliography of 30, 40 articles, and they only have a reference list of two. So, yeah.
Because I put negative mark. I say that there are 1-5.
And I will tell the students explicitly that your bibliography is what you read, your reference list is what you refer to, and that it's a different thing. So it's a totally different thing.
These references, not bibliography.
Yeah. Okay. So I use that textbook so that they at least have in that textbook, it refers to your epistemology, your ontology layer as the philosophy layer. It refers to the next layer. I'll get to, there's a research onion. It describes then the strategy that you take, and then the techniques. So per objective, they have to identify it. And sometimes the population per objective is different. If you're going for an interview, your population is totally different from the people that you use in a questionnaire. Or even if the population is same, your sampling technique is different. So that they have to be very explicit about that, and very explicit about aspects of validity and reliability. If anybody use the trustworthiness model, you're fine to do so. We follow the standardized principle of use trustworthiness as an indicator of reliability and validity. There are three guards in religion: reliability, validity, and generalizability. And thou shalt talk to all three of them. Okay. This is just, it's probably one of the most consistent problems that we get in examination, is if people haven't addressed that or considered it, and haven't considered it from the state that they do their research design. So we force them to do that. So if you use trustworthiness, then it must be noted specifically in there that you're going to use trustworthiness. Okay, and that is the schedule that then that we use for that. Okay. The others I will post. Is there anything specifically anybody is uncomfortable with, not sure about, want to know, want to discuss? Anybody thinks that there's something that I've neglected that you want to have addressed in these assignments?
You must tell them how many hours they should put.
We haven't got units, but the reality is your research proposal is seen as a third of the work of your full research. So we can probably, based on what credits and what units are allocated to the final work out what's the notional hours that we expect students to spend on it.
I just want to ask, the presentation of the proposals is the 1st of June, which is a Saturday.
Yeah.
So I don't want to be negative, but my direct members will not arrive on a Saturday. They work till Friday.
Yeah.
So that I foresee a problem.
Yeah.
With
okay, the problem around that is that we won't have another whole day that we'll get students to come in. So you see, we want the students definitely to be there. So we are going to have additional panel members, but it would be to the students' benefit and to the supervisors' benefit if they are part of that process of giving feedback.
Now,
I think it would be good to have it in the week, but I can't see you actually booking a full day off in the week and getting the students.
Is it an exam?
We can have
it
different.
So we might do it.
Okay.
Yeah, there's no classes, so there's flexibility.
Okay.
And do you have to do it for all the students?
Maybe break it up in sessions. Now it's people management and then this.
We can have it like that. We can schedule it like that.
Yeah. Then the attendance will be higher. That's how I was actually envisaging it in my head. That we would have it per department.
Yeah.
But during the week, because as Maria says,
we'll just have to. Can you add a question then for the students?
Yeah.
Whether they would be available in that week?
No. We don't question that kind of question. You don't ask questions that you don't want the answer.
Okay. Just tell the students they will be available.
The schedule will be available at least 2 weeks ahead of time. It is likely to be on these times. Yeah.
No, not the colloquium, the presentation.
Yeah.
Will we be able to assist them with the slides?
Of course you will be. Of course you will be able to assist them at any one point.
The presentation thereof.
I'm going to set up a template. This will be on slide one.
Okay.
This will be on slide two. This will be on slide three. If you want to change, and they will submit it. If you want a change, you will give me a note that you prefer this layout. But for most students, they don't know what to do.
My tutor
submissions.
Yeah.
Will the students be given training on my tutor?
Oops.
Do they need training on my tutor?
Yes, they're not
yes.
even registered.
Okay. What we do is before the first submission, I'll take like 10 minutes in that session.
It's not going to be enough. I can guarantee you that. The students are extremely reluctant to use my tutor in the first place. Especially those at diploma level. So even those that have gone through the diploma level to be tech, to be tech, are reluctant to use it.
Okay.
So the training session is going to need to be early in the program. It may be worthwhile for you to do a brief example submission as well,
okay.
to see that it works, to see that their passwords work, and we'll turn it in.
Yes.
Yes, turn it in will be used automatically on the literature, on assignment 4, and on the final proposal.
That may need to be used before that, because a lot of the students like copy and paste.
Yeah, no, but on the literature, until the literature review, there's no text really. You know, there's these little summaries. So until that time, it's not going to be meaningful to put it in. But that turn it in report will also, of course, be available to you when you assess the literature review. Who of you have worked with Turnitin yet? Have everybody worked with Turnitin? Turnitin is I think that we will have to discuss. Turnitin is sometimes really a pain. When you work with law issues and you quote law you can't paraphrase. So if somebody's working with something with a lot of law, you can get a very, very high percentage. Okay. But it's still right. Or some of them just decide that this layout, because of the consistency of layout, you're going to get a lot of Turnitin reports just on the layout.
But I mean, I think that the one thing is that we probably need a session for the supervisors on Turnitin.
Yeah.
Do you
have a computer center?
Yes.
Do you have a computer center? I think what he's saying about my tutor, you should have that session in the computer area. And they should have a physical trial submission.
Yeah.
What we do sometimes with the students is we make them give their detail and their contact detail.
As a submission.
As a submission.
What you must just remember, if they are not registered, they cannot use it.
No, I've already arranged. I've arranged that they can use it even though they're not registered.
Okay. Anything else that you think we should talk about?
Okay, but so maybe if I can now just summarize, we're going to need a supervisor session on Turnitin, where we talk about how to interpret the Turnitin report. We're going to need a supervisor session on the ethics, okay, which is at the moment for the 12th of April, but there's one person specifically that can't make it. So, maybe if I can just see by a show of hands, what afternoon is the best for everybody? So let's say Monday afternoon, who can make Monday afternoons easily? Sorry?
What time will it be?
It'll be from 1 to 4.
I think we will have to have a session about the assessment of the final document.
Okay.
So after the fifth assignment, the people get together and we can talk about how to interpret it and whatever difficulties it is, so that the final assessment is...
registers so that you don't feel that you're being measured like a student, all right? But please, that's what this whole course is about. And also, if you have students that you still want to get onto the course, you still have until tomorrow afternoon 5 o'clock. So any student that arrives tomorrow afternoon 5 o'clock with a signed form will be allowed on the course, all right?
Thanks. He wants to cut.